Introduction to The Duchess of Malfi. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org.
The Duchess of Malfi by John Webster. Introductory note. Of John Webster's life almost nothing is known. The dates 1580 to 1625 given for his birth and death are conjectural inferences, about which the best that can be said is that no known facts contradict them. The first notice of Webster, so far discovered, shows that he was collaborating in the production of plays for the theatrical manager Henslowe in 1602, and of such collaboration he seems to have done a considerable amount. Four plays exist which he wrote alone: The White Devil, The Duchess of Malfi, The Devil's Law Case, and Appius and Virginia. The Duchess of Malfi was published in 1623, but the date of writing may have been as early as 1611. It is based on a story in Painter's Palace of Pleasure, translated from the Italian novelist Bandello, and it is entirely possible that it has a foundation in fact. In any case, it portrays with a terrible vividness one side of the court life of the Italian Renaissance, and its picture of the fierce quest of pleasure, the recklessness of crime, and the worldliness of the great princes of the Church finds only too ready corroboration in the annals of the time. Webster's tragedies come toward the close of the great series of tragedies of blood and revenge, in which the Spanish tragedy and Hamlet are landmarks, but before decadence can fairly be said to have set in. He, indeed, loads his scene with horrors almost past the point which modern taste can bear, but the intensity of his dramatic situations, and his superb power of flashing in a single line a light into the recesses of the human heart at the crises of supreme emotion, redeems him from mere sensationalism, and places his best things in the first rank of dramatic writing.
Dramatis Personae.
Ferdinand, read by M.B.
Cardinal, read by Matt Jones.
Antonio, read by Martin Giessen.
Delio, read by Andy Minter.
Bosola, read by David Nicol.
Castruccio, read by Bologna Times.
Pescara, read by Kim Stish.
Malatesti, played by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina.
Roderigo, read by David Muncaster.
Silvio, read by Losh Rolander.
Grizzolan, read by Miriam Esther Goldman.
Doctor, read by Hevid.
First Madman, read by Lucy Perry.
Second Madman, read by Barry Eads.
Third Madman, read by Hevid.
The Fourth Madman, played by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina.
The Duchess of Malfi, read by Elizabeth Klett.
Cariola, read by Ariel Lipshaw.
Julia, read by Barony.
Old Lady, read by Storm.
First Pilgrim, read by Lucy Perry.
Second Pilgrim, read by Barry Eads.
First Servant, read by Daniel Hutton.
Executioner, read by Grace Godwin.
Other roles played by members of the company, and narrated by Bologna Times.
End of introductory note.
Act One of The Duchess of Malfi. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org.
The Duchess of Malfi by John Webster. Act One, Scene One. Enter Antonio and Delio.
You are welcome to your country, dear Antonio. You have been long in France. And you return, a very formal Frenchman in your habit. How do you like the French court?
I admire it. In seeking to reduce both state and people to a fixed order, their judicious king begins at home, quits first his royal palace of flattering sycophants, of dissolute and infamous persons, which he sweetly terms his master's masterpiece, the work of heaven. Considering duly that a prince's court is like a common fountain, whence should flow pure silver drops in general. But if to chance some cursed example poison it near the head, death and diseases through the whole land spread. And what is't makes this blessed government but a most provident council, who dare freely inform him the corruption of the times? Though some of the court hold it presumption to instruct princes what they ought to do, it is a noble duty to inform them what they ought to foresee. Here comes Bossola, the only court Gaul. Yet I observe his railing is not for simple love of piety. Indeed, he rails at those things which he wants, would be as lecherous, covetous, or proud, bloody, or envious as any man, if he had means to be so. Here's the cardinal.
Enter cardinal and Bossola.
I do haunt you still.
So?
I've done you better service than to be slighted thus. Miserable age, where the only reward of doing well is the doing of it.
You enforce your merit too much.
I fell into the galleys in your service, where, for 2 years together, I wore 2 towels instead of a shirt, with a knot on the shoulder after the fashion of a Roman mantle. Slighted thus, I will thrive some way. Blackbirds fatten best in hard weather. Why not I in these dog days?
Would you could become honest.
With all your divinity, do but direct me the way to it. I've known many travel far for it, and yet return as arrant knaves as they went forth, because they carried themselves always along with them.
Exit. Cardinal.
Are ye gone? Some fellows, they say, are possessed with the devil, but this great fellow were able to possess the greatest devil, and make him worse.
He hath denied thee some suit.
He and his brother are like plum trees that grow crooked over standing pools. They're rich and overladen with fruit, but none but crows, pies, and caterpillars feed on them. Could I be one of their flattering panders, I would hang on their ears like a horse-leech till I were full, and then drop off. When thou killedst thy sister, thou took'st from justice her most equal balance, and left her naught but her sword.
Oh, mercy!
Now it seems thy greatness was only outward, for thou fall'st faster of thyself than calamity can drive thee. I'll not waste longer time. There!
Stabs him.
Thou hast hurt me!
Again!
Shall I die like a leveret without any resistance? Help! 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 I am slain!
Enter, Ferdinand.
The alarum! Give me a fresh horse! Rally the vaunt-guard, or the day is lost! Yield! Yield! I give you the honors of arms! Shake my sword over you! Will you yield?
Help me! I am your brother!
The devil! My brother fight upon the adverse party!
He wounds the cardinal, and, in the scuffle, gives Bossola his death wound.
There flies your ransom!
Oh, justice! I suffer now for what hath former been. Sorrow is held in the eldest child of sin.
Now, your brave fellows, Caesar's fortune was harder than Pompey's. Caesar died in the arms of prosperity, Pompey at the feet of disgrace. You both died in the field. The pain's nothing. Pain many times taken away with the apprehension of greater, as the toothache with the sight of a barber that comes to pull it out. There's philosophy for you.
Now my revenge is perfect. Sink, thou main cause of my undoing.
Kills Ferdinand.
The last part of my life hath done thee best service.
Give me some wet hay. I'm broken-winded. I do account this world but a dog kennel. I will vaunt credit and affect high pleasures beyond death.
He seems to come to himself now he's so near the bottom.
My sister! Oh, my sister! There's the cause, aunt! Whether we fall by ambition, blood, or lust, like diamonds we are cut with our own dust.
Dies.
Thou hast thy payment, too.
Yes, I hold my weary soul in my teeth. 'Tis ready to part from me. I do glory that thou, which stoodst like a huge pyramid begun upon a large and ample base, shall end in a little point, a kind of nothing.
Enter below Pescara, Malatesta, Rodrigo, and Grisolan.
How now, my lord?
Oh, sad disaster!
How comes this?
Revenge for the Duchess of Malfi, murdered by the Aragonian brethren. For Antonio, slain by this hand. For lustful Julia, poisoned by this man. And lastly, for myself, that was an actor in the main of all, much against mine own good nature, yet in the end neglected.
How now, my lord?
Look to my brother. He gave us these large wounds as we were struggling here in the rushes, and now, I pray, let me be laid by and never thought of.
Dies.
How fatally it seems he did withstand his own rescue.
Thou wretched thing of blood! How came Antonio by his death?
In a mist. I know not how. Such a mistake as I have often seen in a play. Oh, I am gone. We are only like dead walls or vaulted graves that, ruined, yield no echo. Fare you well. It may be pain, but no harm to me to die in so good a quarrel. Oh, this gloomy world! In what a shadow or deep pit of darkness doth womanish and fearful mankind live! Let worthy minds ne'er stagger in distrust to suffer death or shame for what is just. Mine is another.
Dies.
The noble Delio, as I came to the palace, told me of Antonio's being here, and showed me a pretty gentleman, his son and heir.
Enter Delio and Antonio's son.
Oh, sir, you come too late.
I heard so, and was armed for it ere I came. Let us make noble use of this great ruin, and join all our force to establish this young hopeful gentleman in his mother's right. These wretched eminent things leave no more fame behind them than should one fall in a frost and leave his print in snow. As soon as the sun shines, it ever melts, both form and matter. I have ever thought nature doth nothing so great for great men as when she is pleased to make them lords of truth. Integrity of life is fame's best friend, which nobly, beyond death, shall crown the end.
Excellent. End of Act 5. End of The Duchess of Malfi by John Webster.